Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. First of all, a big thank you to all those of you who left comments on last week's programme about the NOAA report. There were some really interesting observations and suggestions in there which we'll try and build into future content of the channel. Several of you mentioned the Blue Ocean event and asked if we could talk more about this phenomenon and explain precisely why its effects would be such a cause for concern. Now that's not a small area of discussion, so it merits some careful research on the scientific data and some expert opinion before putting it together in a video. So look out for that later on in the year. This week though, we're going to concentrate on the parts of the report that talk about the land-based ice up in Greenland. Just to get you warmed up, let's have a look at some of the insanely huge numbers that describe just how large this thing is. I do love a good chart and statistic, as you know, so here's some Wikipedia action for you. The Greenland Ice Sheet is a vast body of ice covering 1,710,000 square kilometres, or 666,000 square miles, roughly 80% of the surface of Greenland. And thanks to another website called thetruesize.com, we can have a look at how Greenland compares in size to countries that we may all be slightly better acquainted with. Here it is draped across North America, and then across into Europe. And for our Asian and Antipodean friends, just so you don't feel left out, here's how it compares to India and then to Australia. So, you know, it's big. In fact, the Greenland Ice Sheet is the second largest ice body in the world after the Antarctic Ice Sheet. It's 2.4 million years old, almost 2,400 kilometres or 1,500 miles long, north to south, and 1,100 kilometres or 680 miles wide at its widest point. The ice itself is on average about 2 kilometres or 1.2 miles thick and more than 3 kilometres or 1.9 miles at its thickest point. Climate scientists use two measures to assess the performance of the ice sheet on an annual basis. The first is something called the surface ice mass balance, sometimes referred to as the surface mass budget, and the second is the total ice mass balance or the total mass budget. So what do our friends at NOAA and in the wider climate community mean by these two terms? There's a very thorough explanation at the website Polar Portal, which is linked to the Danish Meteorological Institute and is also partnered with carbonbrief.org. Here's their basic summary. Glaciers and ice sheets are vast, slow-moving reservoirs of fresh water fed by precipitation, particularly snowfall, and losing mass by melting and carving of icebergs. If more snow falls than is lost to melt or icebergs, then the glacier will grow and advance. And conversely, if more melts and calves than accumulates, it will retreat and shrink. So far, so simple. Surface mass balance in Greenland is dominated by snowfall. Generally, you get accumulation for 9 months of the year, and then you get snow loss, or what the scientists call ablation, through June, July, and August. Layers of snow are gradually compressed into glacier ice and start to flow downslope, driven by surface melt at lower altitudes and more snowfall at the higher points. So surface mass balance drives the internal flow of glaciers. And there are several variables that go into calculating the annual increases and decreases. You've got sublimation, which means snow and ice changing into water vapor in the air without first melting into water. And then the evaporation of the water vapour direct from the surface. And this is an important mass loss process, particularly in the winter. In the summer though, it's good old-fashioned melting that dominates the mass loss. The Danish Meteorological Institute, or DMI, used data from PROMIS and GCNET weather stations, as well as their own automatic weather stations, to crunch the numbers. They use a fairly complex set of parameters to work out the amount of melting, which gives them an equation that looks like this. Yeah, I know. So this bit is net shortwave radiation, which means how much sunlight hits the surface minus how much sunlight is reflected back because of the albedo or reflectiveness. This next bit is the net longwave radiation, which means how much radiation comes from the atmosphere and the clouds, minus how much the surface radiates through something called surface emissivity. QE describes the transfer of energy due to the difference in temperature between the surface and the atmosphere. It's the thing that causes wind chill factor. QL represents something called enthalpy. If you saw last week's video, you'll remember we talked about latent heat of fusion. Well, that is enthalpy, and there's also a latent heat of evaporation. In fact, enthalpy happens at every phase change: melting, evaporating, freezing, and sublimation. QE and QL are strongly dependent on the air temperature, humidity, and wind speeds. GE stands for ground heat flux. Essentially, this is an energy transfer to and from the subsurface, which results in the surface temperature or skin temperature. As the polar portal puts it, the skin is best imagined as an infinitesimally thin layer at the surface. On a glacier, we assume that this temperature cannot reach above the melting point, and since the first law of thermodynamics applies, any additional energy is available for melt, which is the ME. This melt calculation is added to the other variables to give an overall calculation for surface mass balance. Surface mass balance equals precipitation minus evaporation minus sublimation minus runoff, with runoff being melt plus rainfall minus refreezing. And the actual results from these clever calculations? Well, according to the website Science Nordic, who get their information from the scientists at the DMI and Polar Portal, for this year we calculated a total SMB of 517 billion tonnes, which is almost 150 billion tonnes above the average for 1981 to 2010, ranking just behind the 2016-17 season as sixth highest on record. Here's what the folks at Carbon Brief say about 2018. The melt season started as normal in May, but it was a relatively cold month. The summit station at the very top of Greenland even set a new record low for the month when it dropped to minus 46.3 degrees Celsius on the 9th of May. In addition, late spring snowfall in early June restricted melting, and the ablation season, when ice melts and runs off the ice sheet into the ocean, didn't really get going until the last week of June. Further fresh snow over much of southern Greenland in early July again replenished the snow at the surface and reduced melt rates. Fresh snow not only indicates cold weather, it also reduces melting, as it's very bright and reflective compared to darker old snow and bare glacier ice, which is often covered in dirt and dust and algae. Typically, summer melt rates increase as the darker snow and ice is exposed, which absorbs more solar energy, leading to more melting, the so-called ice albedo feedback. This summer, the frequent snowstorms replenished the bright white surface on several occasions, holding back the albedo feedback from accelerating melt through the season. And importantly, they also note, the period 2003 to 2011 has seen ice sheet losses on Greenland averaging 234 billion tonnes each year. The neutral mass change in the last 2 years does not and cannot begin to compensate for these losses. The comparison here does show that in any given year, the mass budget of the ice sheet is highly dependent on regional climate variability and specific weather patterns. So to get from surface ice mass balance or budget to total ice mass balance, the scientists have to take into account some other factors, most notably the calving of the glaciers, which in basic terms that I can understand means the bit at the end of the glacier that drops off into the sea. The report card tells us, marine terminating glaciers are the outlets by which the Greenland ice sheet discharges ice mass to the ocean. The 2017-18 net area change of the 47 surveyed glaciers relative to the previous year, it's plus 4.1 square kilometres and stands alone as the only year in the survey with an area gain. The annual area loss per year averaged over the 19-year period of record between 2000 and 2017 is minus 109.7 square kilometres per year. NOAA and the DMI and Polar Portal and just about anybody else all rely quite heavily on satellite data to calculate the total mass balance number. Since 2002, this has been provided by NASA's Twin Gravity Recovery and Climate Experiment satellites, otherwise known as GRACE. But the original NASA GRACE mission ended in October 2017. Those of you interested in space stuff may have watched the launch by SpaceX of the GRACE follow-on or GRACE FO mission back on the 22nd of May 2018. The engineering accuracy involved in these instruments really is breathtaking. Just take a listen to this commentary from the live SpaceX launch transmission.
Now the two GRACE satellites fly in orbit about 220 kilometers apart. The satellites use microwave radio frequency signals to measure the distance between them. The measurement is accurate to about the thickness of a blood cell. It's incredibly accurate.
Absolutely incredible. Anyway, the data from those two new satellites is currently being reviewed for quality control purposes, and sadly there's no data available from space between October 2017 and May 2018. The next set of data that will come out will be for the summer 2018, and that's going to be calibrated against the old GRACE satellites to make sure it's accurate, and we'll do a recap video when those numbers come out. In the meantime though, here's NASA's take on the direction of travel up in Greenland. The mass of the Greenland ice sheet has rapidly been declining over the last several years due to surface melting and iceberg calving. Research based on the GRACE satellites indicates that between 2003 and 2013, Greenland shed approximately 280 gigatons of ice per year, causing global sea levels to rise by 0.8 millimeters every year. I must admit, that did turn out to be a bit more complicated than I expected. I hope it all made sense though, and as always, if there are some technical points of correction that you folks need to make, then feel free to leave your edits in the comments section below. That's it for this week though. Please do give us a like and a share, and most importantly, if you haven't already done so, consider joining us by subscribing to the channel. It really does help raise the profile of the channel and get the message across to more and more people each week. And if you hit the little bell icon, you get notified whenever a new program comes out. It's completely free and dead easy to subscribe. All you need to do is follow this link. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.